Good morning. Good to see everybody today. I love to hear people talking together, having fellowship with each other as we gather. Great to see everybody. We have a number of guests with us today, and we're happy you're with us as well. And if you would, please fill out a guest card, which you'll find on the back of the pew in front of you, and just leave it on the pew or put it in the collection box in the back. We would appreciate that. We'd like to send you a little thank you note. But great to have everybody here today. It's a wonderful day to gather with your brothers and sisters and worship the Lord. If you have not gotten a communion cup, please raise your hand and we'll have one brought to you. And for those of you who have children, in a few minutes when we get ready to hear a lesson from God's Word today, you'll see a little lineup of children ages 2 through 7 going to children's Bible time where they'll have appropriate age teaching. And if you'd like your child to join in, please do so. You're welcome to attend with them. But great to have everybody here today. As we begin, I'm going to read the 30th Psalm. And the psalmist says, "I will extol you, O Lord, for you have lifted me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cried out to you and you healed me. O Lord, you brought my soul up from the grave. You have kept me alive that I should not go down to the pit. Sing praise to the Lord, you saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Now in my prosperity I said, I shall never be moved. Lord, by your favor, you have made my mountain stand strong. You hid your face, and I was troubled. I cried out to you, O Lord, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it declare your truth? Hear, O Lord, and have mercy on me. Lord, be my helper. You have turned for me my mourning into dancing. You have put off my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness, to the end that my glory may sing praises to you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks to you evermore." Let's all praise the Lord.
Good morning.
Our first song this morning is "We're Marching to Zion."
Come we that love the Lord and have our souls to Zion. Join in on the song to see the Lord. Join in on the song to speak up for and bless us all.
Come on.
For our prayer this morning, we'll sing, "There is a Stirring."
Let us pray. Dear Lord in heaven, we humbly come before you in our period of worship to you this morning. We thank you for allowing us to be in your presence, to feel you're here with us in your spirit, to know that you love us and that you have provided for us so many blessings in this life. Lord, we come to worship you as the true and the living God, the one who has told us about yourself in the Bible, about all the amazing things that you have done for your creation here on this earth. We believe that you have created this world and have placed everything here for us to know more about you and to appreciate you and your characteristics and your great love for us. We especially thank you for your word that you give us through the Bible, that tells us about you and about your plan for us, about how you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, by his dying on the cross for our sins. Please help us to accept what Christ has done for us and to believe and to trust in that and to know that we are your children because of Christ. Dear Lord, we ask that you would help us to pay more attention to your word as we studied in our class this morning, to be readers of your word on a daily basis, and to not just be readers, but to be appliers, ones who meditate on your word and let it be a light unto our feet, to help us to walk in the pathways that you desire for us to have the wisdom that you provide if we will only ask for it. Dear, we please help us to have thoughts that are like yours and not of this world and like humans want to have, but to help us to love one another and to care for one another just as you care for us and like Christ has cared for the church. We are thankful to you for this congregation of people that meets here, for each one that does their part in helping this congregation through use of their talents and their desire to serve you. We ask that you would bless each one of us and help us as we strive to encourage one another and to be a light in this community. Please help us to reach out to those who are not of our membership, but who desperately need your love and your care also. Lord, we are thankful for the elders that you have provided for this congregation. We ask that you would strengthen them and guide them and help them to have the wisdom that they need to lead this congregation. Please help the teachers and the others that participate in doing things in manners that we see to be guided by your wisdom and your blessings, so that they might encourage this congregation and strengthen it. We are thankful to those who do things outside this building that are necessary for your people, that are encouraging people who are not feeling well, who are taking care of those needs of them. We are thankful to you for those people also. Lord, we thank you for this time that we have to worship you as a congregation, so that we might see that the other people are like-minded and are doing similar things as we desire to do. Please help us to sing these songs of praises to your name in an uplifting voice and cheerful, and listen to the words that are there, especially those that are telling us about you and our hope for that we have through Christ of being with you forever in heaven. Dear Lord, please guide us and help us to worship you in spirit and truth this morning, as we know that you desire for us to do. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
As we approach the part of our service where we're going to partake of the Lord's Supper, we're going to sing "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross" to prepare our minds.
Oh,
If you have not received a Lord's Supper communion, raise your hand and somebody in the back will see and get it for you. Our scripture focus today is Romans 8, verse 1 and verse 37. In chapter 6, shall we sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Chapter 7, in the flesh, it's a wretchedness. There's no solution outside of the law of Christ, outside of the law of Spirit. Verse 1, Romans 8. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. This entire chapter is about this or that. Well, we're here gathering at this table, this feast, but this memorial, it's a celebration, and yet it's a remembrance. Jesus died that we might live. We have mortified the works of the flesh in our bodies to live the Spirit of life, the Spirit of Christ, the law of His Word in our lives. Verse 34, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. I have forever thought of this keeping of the Lord's Supper as an open casket. Only our loved one, Jesus Christ, he's not in that casket because he's risen. He's not there, but he is here. We remember his death, beginning with this taking of the bread in remembrance of his body, and then in a moment taking of the fruit of the vine in remembrance of his blood that was shed for all of us, that he might live in us as we remember these things. Let's bow our heads and pray for the bread. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your Son. Thank you for your love. Thank you for sending him to die a cruel, though cruel, death. A death that sin deserved. Thank you for his body upon that cross, for by his death we might live. We ask you now that you would bless this bread, that we might partake of it in a manner well-pleasing unto thee. And in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Shall we bow again? Dear Heavenly Father, we ask you now to bless this cup this remembrance of your son's death. We ask you, bless it. Bless us as we partake of it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank him, and we show that gratitude in giving back to him a portion that we've set aside just for that. We have boxes in the back for collection that's been set aside upon the first day of the week. We set this time aside for prayer that as you leave or come in, whenever, that you will give back unto him as the churches did, so do we. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for our life. Thank you for our livelihoods. Thank you for so many gifts, so much charity from you, charity that we've received, charity that we've given. Pray, Father, that we can all have hearts of thankfulness and then giving back unto you, that you will bless what we give to the furtherance of your work. We ask you this in Christ's name. Amen.
Before our lesson this morning, we'll sing, "It Is Well With My Soul." Let's stand as we sing.
Yeah.
Good morning. It's great to see everyone here this cold morning. Glad the cold didn't keep you in, and glad the ridiculous time change that for whatever reason we still adhere to didn't mess you up. I guess maybe it could have and you just thought you were here for Bible study, but nonetheless, we're glad you're here. I do want to make one quick announcement regarding the teen group. The teen group will meet at our house next Sunday, the 20th, at 5 p.m. So if you have someone sixth grade to senior in high school, we would love it if you would bring them to be a part of that. And that'll just be a good time and fellowship. Dinner will be provided. And so if you'd like to take part in that and have any questions, please see me or Kinley, and we'll answer any questions you may have. This morning, I want to talk to you about privilege. And I already see a couple of feathers ruffling, because that's become sort of a buzzword, a controversial topic or word in recent years. And I'm not going to really add any comment to that discussion other than to say that I think when it comes to any kind of privilege or ability or good fortune or good circumstance that we experience, I think we would do well to be aware of and grateful for it, whatever it may be. But this morning I want to talk to you about spiritual privilege. Spiritual privileges that we experience as Christians. And to do that, I want to look at a passage in which Peter addresses Christians who I think at the very least were at risk of losing sight of the privileges they shared as Christians and partakers of the gospel. And so I hope you have your Bible with you. If you'd like to turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, that's going to be the basis of our lesson this morning. But I think this will serve as a good reminder for us as well, because I think we tend to lose sight of the privileges we enjoy as Christians. It's easy for us to think about the burdens that come with Christianity, the difficulties, the challenges, rather than focus on the benefits, the blessings that come as Christians. And so we're going to begin reading in 1 Peter 1, chapter 3. Or I'm sorry, 1 Peter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Now, if you're paying close attention or you've studied the book of 1 Peter, you know that Peter is writing to a group of people, a group of Christians who are being persecuted, or who are enduring difficult, challenging circumstances as a result of their faith. If we had read in verse 1, we would have seen that Peter describes them as aliens residing in a foreign land, Christians who are scattered throughout Asia in what is modern-day Turkey, essentially. If we were to skip ahead to the end of the book, in chapter 5, verse 13, we see that Peter refers to those in Babylon, not because Babylon is still around. If you know your history, it's not. But Peter's calling back to a time in which the nation of Judah is destroyed and captured, and they live in captivity in a foreign nation, living as foreigners. In verse 6, which we read, Peter references that they are distressed by various trials. In chapter 4 and verse 12, he references the fiery ordeal among them. And we know through history and during the time that this is being written, about the mid-60s AD, or around 30 years or so after the death of Christ, that there's very severe, harsh persecution taking place of Christians at the hands of the Roman Empire and as well at the hands of the Jews. So you can imagine that if you're a Christian living in this time, you know, that might be what's at the forefront of your mind, these difficult circumstances. I mean, why am I putting myself through this? I can just be like those around me and life will be easy, life will be better. And so Peter knows that these Christians need to be encouraged. They need to be reminded of the privilege that comes with being a Christian. And so I want to look at six privileges that we see here in these verses that we just read. Six privileges that come from the gospel and from being a Christian. The first we see is mercy. Peter tells us it's according to his great mercy that Christ died for us, that we can experience and enjoy these things. It's not because we deserve it, not because we've earned it. It is because of mercy. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 4 and 5, "But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved." So not only did we not really earn it, we in fact did the opposite. We deserved destruction, death. But despite the way we're living, despite our sin, Christ died for us because of his mercy. And so we're not afforded this kind of privilege because of who we are, who our parents are, who we're born into. It's only because of God's mercy and grace. The second privilege I think we see here is renewal. Renewal. Peter tells us that we are born again. And that really makes me think of the conversation Jesus has back in John chapter 3 with Nicodemus. You remember that? Nicodemus comes essentially in secret because he's someone with a lofty position. It would have been very controversial for him to be seeking out Jesus among his cohorts. And Jesus almost, it seems like it's almost kind of unprompted, but what does Jesus say to him? "Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And so Nicodemus is understandably kind of taken aback by that. I mean, how does that work? Do you go back inside the womb and come out again? I mean, what are you talking about, Jesus? But Jesus says, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." And we don't really see a full explanation there, at least it's not recorded for us. But as the gospel unfolds, we begin to understand more about what this idea of being born again is. If you look over in Romans chapter 6 and verse 3, Paul says, "Or do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life." We're born again. We're renewed. And so when we're baptized, this old life of sin dies, buried in the waters of baptism, when we rise as a new creation, renewed. What are we born into? Well, if I can get this work. A living hope. A hope that life does not end in death. That one day those who are dead in Christ will rise, and those who are alive in Christ will rise to meet him in the sky when he returns. That this is, life is not the end of all things. And if you're a Christian living in those times, going through those things, how important would it be to have that hope? To know that this life is not all that there is. If you're a Christian who's afraid that tonight somebody's going to come and take you from your home, take you from your family, and throw you in prison because of your faith, and perhaps you know someone who that's already happened to, how important would it be to have hope? And so that is what Peter reminds them of. Hope for a future in which there's no suffering, there's no sorrow, but an eternity with God. Hope also of an inheritance. An inheritance. As children of God, we have an inheritance, not one that's of money or material possession, not something that's tangible, not something that will go away, that will disappear, something that lasts, something that is eternal. It's not defiled or corruptible, as the King James translates it. When I think of inheritances, I think of the prodigal son. Remember how that starts? The prodigal son goes to his father and demands his inheritance right now. Okay. And that inheritance didn't really turn out to be a blessing or a good thing for him, did it? It corrupted him. And very quickly we see it disappears. And that mankind, we're pretty good at making a large amount of money become a little bit of money, right? We're pretty good at that. But this is an inheritance that is not corruptible. It is not going to disappear, and it is waiting for us in heaven. Protection. Protection. Christians are offered protection. Again, how significant would that be to someone who's afraid that you're going to be killed or imprisoned? Peter's not really talking about physical protection, though. Because God's not going to remove the challenges that face them. He's telling them they have to endure them, that they're being tested, that these serve to prove their faith. But in the context of this, Peter's talking about spiritual protection. God protects the souls of his people. Look over in Romans 8, verse 31, and we took a brief glimpse at this passage during our observance of the Lord's Supper. But look at what Paul says, beginning in verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Just as it is written, for your sake we are being put to death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But in all things we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Notice, like Peter, Paul doesn't say you're not going to have to deal with things like this. Because you're a Christian, you won't have to suffer these things. But it's that none of these things are going to separate you from the love of God. It doesn't matter what some Roman court says about you. It doesn't matter what you're charged with in this life. Because God is the ultimate judge. God is the one who justifies. And so we see that God protects the souls of his people. Finally, salvation. Perhaps the most important of all of these blessings, these privileges, is salvation. The ultimate reason for Christ coming and dying for us is so that we would have salvation through his sacrifice. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And so despite these trials that the Christians are facing, despite all of the difficulties that they face, Peter is actually telling them that they should rejoice. Doesn't really make sense, right? But they should rejoice because of these privileges, and especially because of the salvation that will come from this. These trials are going to prove their faith, and the result of their faith will be salvation. Now, as we keep reading in verse 10, Peter continues to talk about this salvation. And it really becomes kind of the focal point of this whole passage. And so he further elaborates on this privilege of salvation by going back, actually, to the prophets. And so read with me in verse 10, going back to 1 Peter 1. As to this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful searches and inquiries, seeking to know what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you, in these things which now have been announced to you through those who preach the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Have you ever wanted to live in Old Testament times? Have you ever thought it would be interesting? I think about what a privilege it would have been to see the things that God did in the Old Testament. How amazing would it have been to see the 10 plagues, to see the parting of the Red Sea? What would it have been like to see some of these grand battles in which the Israelites faced insurmountable odds and yet they were delivered by the intervention of God? What would it have been like to be Abraham or Moses or any other of the prophets that spoke directly with God? I think what a privilege it would have been. But you know what? I think that those men would trade places with us. I think they would love to live in our day and age. Not because of the technological advances that we have, not because of the much easier way of life that we enjoy. Instead, I think they would love to be in our position because as Christians, we live in a time in which the full mystery of God, of His plan of salvation has been revealed. All these promises of the Messiah that they only had just a small window into, a small glimpse of, have been fully revealed and made known to us. They would long for the privilege we have as Christians to see that full glory of God's plan of salvation. And I just want to think for a second about some of these glimpses when we look back. I mean, really, you can go back to Genesis 3:15 in the beginning. You see the very first prophecy. Adam and Eve have sinned in the garden, and so God is addressing all of those involved. And when he's speaking to the serpent and Satan, he says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. So we have reference to this reconciliation that is going to happen all the way back in the garden. Satan will deal a non-fatal blow to the seed of woman. The seed of woman is going to deal a killing blow to Satan. And we see that fulfilled on the cross and in the resurrection. I think about Abraham in Genesis chapter 12 and verse 3. One of those promises that you might remember to Abraham. One of those, in you all families of the earth will be blessed. And it doesn't seem like Abraham is fully explained what that means. At least we're not told that. But Abraham is told about this wonderful thing that is going to happen. All nations will be blessed through our family. He had to have thought about it regularly. He had to have talked about it with Sarah and his family. What a great thing God is going to accomplish through our family. But still, just a glimpse. Think about Moses. Look at what the Hebrew writer says about Moses in Hebrews chapter 11. Verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, considering the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking for the reward. So we see Moses, even though the Messiah is not going to come for many centuries, Moses is already looking forward to the Christ, and it is affecting how he lives, how he chooses to live. Notice how Moses is essentially doing exactly what Peter is calling on Christians to do. I mean, he had every opportunity to be a part of the wealthiest, most powerful nation at the time. I mean, he's in the household of Pharaoh, and he gives that up to be with the people of God. That's what Peter's calling on the people of God to do. You have to forsake the things of this world. It may mean you have to endure trials, but that is because your reward is not in this life. And that is what Moses recognized. But even he, a man who we're told talked to God face to face as a friend, even he just had a small glimpse into what was to come. And the last one very quickly, Daniel. Daniel in chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. We read, I kept looking in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like a son of man was coming, and he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom that all the peoples, nations, and men of every language might serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which will not pass away, and his kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. What it must have been like for Daniel to consider this vision, to think about what it would mean, how magnificent it would be that all nations, people of every language, would one day be God's people, not just the nation of Israel. Think about the context in which Daniel's living. He's part of this group that's carried into captivity in Babylon. Eventually, Babylon is destroyed. So he has seen a lot of destruction, nations being toppled. And so what would it have been like for Daniel to think about a kingdom that's going to last forever? A king who will rule forever. What marvelous things God is bringing about, planning, but still just a glimpse. And so Peter tells us that the men and women of the Old Testament longed to know more about what God was doing, what he was planning. They longed to have the full mystery revealed, to see these promises fulfilled. And so we're told they searched, they anxiously considered looking for the Messiah, but they just had these small glimpses. We're even told that the angels, too, longed to know the full mystery. Yet it is us who have the privilege, who have seen God's glorious plan of salvation fully revealed to us through his Son. And so what a privilege it is to live in a time in which we can know God's full plan, the full plan of salvation. And not only has it been made known to us, but we can partake in it. What a privilege. And so what should our response be? What does it all mean for us? It's not good enough to simply know these things. And if you're peeking ahead in verse 13, back in 1 Peter 1, you'll notice that Peter writes, therefore. Okay, so we would do well to take a look and see what he says. Based on all these things, what should we do? Let's keep reading in verse 13. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, be holy, or because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. And there's a lot of things we could say, and perhaps these few verses deserve their own sermon. But I just want to leave you with three instructions that I think we see here in these few verses that Peter gives us. First, we need to prepare our mind. Prepare our minds. in light of these privileges, in light of the challenges that we face, we need to prepare our minds. And some translations, like the King James Version, say, gird up the loins of your mind. And that's a term we really only see in the Bible, and maybe you know what it refers to, but in case you don't, what that really refers to is, you know, back in those days, I don't think pants existed, but I know they didn't really wear pants. They wore tunics, kind of like dresses, even the men. And so if you were going to engage in any vigorous activity, you couldn't, you know, go to battle wearing a dress because you were going to get tripped up. And so what you would do is you would gather up all those loose ends and you would wrap them up and tie them off. You would gird your loins. And that's what you would do if you were going to engage in any physical labor or even go to battle. And so we need to prepare our minds in the same way that we would prepare our bodies for any type of action. Because the gospel calls us to act. It's not something that we do from the sidelines in a vegetative state. We need to prepare our minds by getting rid of those loose ends, if you will, things that distract us from our service to God. And so Peter tells us to focus on grace. Philippians 4, verse 8, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence, if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. Prepare your mind for action. Second, we need to be obedient. As children of God, we have to be obedient. And how does Peter describe obedience? Do not be conformed to the former lusts, which were yours in your ignorance. We have to stop living the way that we were living. If you go back to Romans 6, that passage starts by, it seems that people were just living how they wanted to, knowing that grace was there and that, you know, if we just keep sinning, grace will keep flowing. But what does Paul say? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin live in it? As Peter told us, we've been born again and we're a new creation. So, because of the mercy, the grace we've received, we have to stop living as we once lived. We have to respond with obedience. And finally, be holy. The call to obedience really stems from this final instruction. Peter tells us to be holy. Why? Because God is holy. God has no part in sin, corruption, any impure thing. He is apart from those things. And we need to strive to be set apart from those things as well. You remember Peter addressed the people in his letter as aliens at the beginning. And that's not a derogatory term. That's a description of how they were living and how they should live. They should be appearing as foreigners, not the kind of foreigners that absorb the culture around them, that assimilate, but people who look different, who act different, who live different. Our God is holy. And therefore, we should be holy. So prepare your mind, be obedient, and be holy. I hope this passage has been encouraging to you and will be encouraging to you going forward as it has been to me. And if you're here this morning, you're not a Christian, I hope at the very least this has given you something to think about, to hear these blessings, these privileges. You need to know that they're not the kind that come from your background, who you're born into, doesn't matter what color of skin you have, you can obtain these privileges. And I hope you'll think about these things this week, but if you're already at the point that you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and that you're ready to make a change, well then you can make that confession today. You can repent of your sin, you can be washed in the waters of baptism, and you can be born again, as Peter talked about. And so if you'd like to do that, if you'd like to be baptized, I'd encourage you to do today. But I know that many of you have already done that, and perhaps you're sitting here thinking about these things and you're not following those instructions that Peter gives. You're not living as you should. And I want you to know that you're not alone, because I've been there and I know the rest of us have all been there. But if you'd like to make that known, if you'd like to request the prayers and help of the brethren here, then you can make that known as well. If anyone's subject to the invitation, then come while we stand and sing.
O Lord, your beautiful, your
Your face is all I can see. And your eyes are on this child. Your face abounds in me.
Good job, Jared. Thank you for that lesson. And once again, we thank all of you for being here. If you've not already gotten an announcement sheet, please pick one up as you leave. And that has most of our announcements. I have a few things to add to that. First of all, some good news. Sister Kaylin Jeffords has asked to be a part of us here. She is right over in this area. Raise your hand for them. She's a little bashful, but get over there and see her. And welcome her to our congregation. I do have a thank you note I'd like to read. And it says, thanks for all the cards, food, and prayers. I'm feeling a lot better. If I were to make a list of all your special qualities, words like thoughtful, caring, and loving would come to mind today and always. I thank God for having you in my life. In Christian love, Beverly Penny. We're glad to see Beverly back today. And please continue to remember her in your prayers. And I have an announcement for the from the Norton family. Brothers and sisters, the doctors have ceased all treatments for Linda Norton. Hospice has been called, and we ask for your prayers as we move through this difficult time. Let's go to our Father in prayer. Holy Father, we're thankful for all that you do for us. We're thankful for the love you show to us each and every day. And we thank you for all the people that you put in our pathway. We're so thankful for Linda and her life. We've known her for years and years. And at this time in her life, when it looked like that transition is coming, Father, we just pray that you'll be with her, strengthen her in spirit, strengthen her in her faith, give her comfort to face what is soon to be coming. And Father, we also pray that you'll be with Jennings and all the Norton family at this time. Give them strength to see it through. Give them the patience and the love for you. And Father, just give them the strength that they need. And help us, Father, to be a part of that. Help us to do what we can in prayer and in person that we can strengthen them through this time. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And most of you know we've put the name of Jed Yancey before you to be a second evangelist full-time here. Please talk with Jed, talk with the elders, let them know what you think, Father. And we look forward to him becoming a part of the work here, a bigger part of the work here. Remember small groups today. If you're not in a small group, we have a group meeting at 6 p.m. here at the building back in room A1. You're welcome to be a part of that, but please take advantage of these small groups and as we strengthen each other through them. Also remember, of course, Wednesday night Bible classes for all ages, Thursday morning Bible class for adults at 10 o'clock, and of course then next Sunday morning, be back with us again as we worship together. Good to have everyone here. If you're a guest today, thanks for coming. Hope you can come back soon, and we wish you Godspeed.
Before we're led in our closing prayer, we'll sing Anywhere is Home. We'll just sing the first verse. You'll see the second verse come up, but we're just singing the first one. Earthly wealth.
Let's go to our Father in prayer. Our Lord and our God, as we come to the end of this worship service, we pray that we have praised your name, that we have glorified you, and that you have been pleased with our worship. We pray, O Lord, that we would recognize the privileges we have, the responsibilities we have to do those things which we were instructed to do, and we thank you, O God, for your word, for your Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And we ask that you go with us, watch over and protect us, and bring us back at the next appointed time. In Christ's holy name, amen.